Well, BookTube, it's time to make another video. I'm sitting here in the dining room. It's 8:15 at night on April the 14th, 2017. It is a Friday night here in West Michigan. So I'm sitting here making a video. Tonight, in my diary today, I ended on page 339. And we're in the middle of the month. So tomorrow will be in the 15th, and then I go into the second folder, which I didn't bring with me. So yeah, I usually write about 3 pages a day. I take notes when I'm reading, so it's not just full text. But that's where I'm at in my diary. I got tomorrow already, April the 15th, 2017. If I don't die during the night, I'll be on page 340. Tomorrow morning is a Saturday. Saturdays I volunteer at the local library used bookstore, the Book Nook. I had to cover for someone Thursday from 3 to 5. My free book for volunteering can't be over $2. This is hardbacks, if they're not new, at the Book Nook are $2. If they're 2016, they're $3. But most of the books I find there, now sometimes they do have higher priced books. Like I showed you that book by Brandis on Truman and MacArthur. That was a $6 book, but that is not normal there. Most books are either $1 or $2. But this book was a $2 book, was my free book for volunteering Thursday from 3 to 5. The Smell of Battle and the Taste of Siege, A Sensuary History of the Civil War by Mark M. Smith. I do have a large Civil War collection. I think I've mentioned that when we were in seminary in Jackson, Mississippi, we were just down the road from us was Vicksburg, which was a very a major battle during the Civil War took place, the Battle of Vicksburg. And we would go there and look at the battlefield. Our children, especially our 2 boys, were really into the Civil War. We had friends in seminary who were Civil War buffs and gave our boys all kinds of stacks and stacks of Civil War books. And I still collect them. And now I'm not an authority on the Civil War. I've read a little bit, but my oldest boy, Caleb, was really into the Civil War. So was our middle son, Josiah. Josiah even did a report in middle school that his favorite hero was Robert E. Lee. So anyway, but this is a book on the Civil War, looking at the smells and taste that a person would experience in battle or something in the Civil War. I bought for $1.50 a novel that looked kind of interesting at the Book Nook Thursday, late afternoon, early evening. This is called The Little Stranger by Sarah Waters. It was a man Booker Prize finalist. It's kind of like a gothic kind of mystery kind of thing. It says here on the back here, one post-war summer in his home of rural, she's a British writer, Sarah Waters. She's British, she's not American. One post-war summer in his home of rural Wickshire, Dr. Faraday, the son of a maid who has built a life of quiet respectability as a country physician, is called to a patient at Lonely Hundreds Hall, home to the Irie's family for over 2 centuries. The Georgianian Georgian house, once impressive and handsome, is now in decline. Its masonry crumbling, its gardens choked with weeds, the clock in its stable yard permanently fixed at 20 to 9. Its owners, mother, son, and daughter, are struggling to keep pace with a changing society, as well with conflicts of their own. But are the Arises haunted by something more sinister than a dying way of life? Little does Dr. Faraday know how closely and how terrifyingly their story is about to become entwined with his. So I don't know. You know, it looked kind of interesting. I glanced through it. It looked well written. It had good reviews from Newsday, Seattle Times, The Washington Post, The New York Times Book Review, the Boston Globe, Library Journal, The Guardian, The Telegraph, The Independent. So I bought it for $1.50. That was Thursday. As far as what I've been reading, Thursday I read at the Book Nook Zama by Antonio de Bento, translated by Esther Allen. I've been reading this. I'm halfway through it. It's kind of like, it's a story of, it was first published in 1956. Zama is now universally recognized as one of the masterpieces of modern Argentinian and Spanish language literature. Written in a style that is both precise and sumptuous. Zama takes place in the last decade of the 18th century and describes the solitary, suspended existence of Don Diego de Zama, a highly placed servant of the Spanish crown who has been posted to Acazone in a remote Paraguay, eaten up by pride, lust, petty grudges, paranoid fantasies. Don Diego does as little as he possibly can while plotting an eventual transfer to Buenos Aires, where everything about his hopeless existence will, he is confident, be miraculously transformed and made good. Don Diego's slow, nightmarish slide into the abyss is not just a tale of one man's perdition, but an exploration of existential in a very American loneliness. Zuma's stark, dreamlike prose and spare imagery makes every word appear to emerge from an ocean of things left unsaid. Yeah, I'm really enjoying this. Like I said, I've been reading it slowly since I got this last month, maybe 2 months ago. But I'm slowly reading it, and I'm enjoying it. I got this in the mail today. This was mentioned on BookTube. This is a Penguin Modern Classic by Mihail, Sebastian. The title of the novel is 2,000 Years, which was translated, I think it was translated out of Romanian language by Philip O. Clea, 2,000 Years. So I don't know much about it, except it has great reviews. It's considered a modern classic. And it says here, absolutely, definitively alone, a young Jewish student in Romania tries to make sense of a world that has decided he doesn't belong, spending his days walking the streets and nights drinking and gambling, meeting revolutionaries, zealots, lovers, and libertines. He adjusts his eye to the darkness that falls over Europe. Now, this was written in 1934, so this is right at the time of the rise of the Nazis and the disintegration of European culture. This is now translated into English for the first time, was written amid anti-Semitism, which would by the end of the decade, in the 1930s, force him out of his career and turn his friends and colleagues against him. For 2,000 years as a looking into the future, heart-wrenching chronicle of resilience, despair, and the terrible forces of history. So I got this in the mail today. As far as what I've been reading today, what did I read today? Oh, today I read Spirit Hermeneutics, Reading Scripture in Light of Pentecost by Greg S. Keener. This is Good Friday. This is when we, as Christians, think upon the death of Christ upon the cross, dying for sinners. I still been reading the Bible Supernaturally by John Piper. And tonight I'm going to read Scripture as Real Presence, Sacramental Exegesis in the Early Church by Hans Boersma. Now today I left the house to go for a walk out in Mother Nature, or Mother Nature, or there is just east of us, there's the upper Makatawa natural area. So I went there for a walk this morning. The sun was shining, the birds were out. I took pictures, I posted them in my online diary, Crooked Fingers, and my Flickr account. But as I was coming home from my walk this morning, I stopped at a local thrift store just a couple blocks from where we live, and I picked up these used books for just $2.81. This is a novel by Graham Greene, The Ministry of Fear. I was really surprised. I have a huge collection of his writings, but I didn't have this one. I bought it because my logic is if I do have it, I'll take it to the book nook. But I didn't have this one by Graham Greene, Ministry of Fear. And I picked up four novels by James Baldwin. This one I had in my James Baldwin collection, If Beale Street Could Talk. This is a novel. But I didn't have James Baldwin's novel, Go Tell on the Mountain. And I didn't have his play, Blues for Mr. Charlie. I didn't have this in our James Baldwin collection. And I didn't have this collection of essays and autobiography kind of excerpts by James Baldwin. Nobody Knows My Name, More Notes of Native Son. It says here, James Baldwin's Nobody Knows My Name records the last months of this famed American writer's 10-year self-exile in Europe, his return to America and Harlem, his first trip south at the time of the school integration battles. It contains Mr. Baldwin's controversial intimate profiles of Norman Mailer, Richard Wright, Ingmar Bergman. Explores such varied themes as the relations between Negroes and whites, the role of Negro in America and in Europe, and the question of sexual identity. James Baldwin was a homosexual, if I remember. And so I was pleased to find these for our James Baldwin collection. I've been reading him since I can remember. I found from my Ayn Rand collection, We Are Living. I didn't have this. I wasn't sure also, but I figured I could take it to the book nook, but I didn't have this in my collection. This is a novel that first published in 1936. The theme of this classic novel is the struggle of the individual against the state. It portrays the impact of the Russian Revolution on three human beings who demand the right to live their own lives and pursue their own happiness. It tells of a young woman's passionate love held like a fortress against the corrupting evil of a totalitarian state. So, and I have this one by Norman Mailer, but I collect his writings. I have almost all of them except his Life of Jesus and something else by him. But The Armies of the Night, History as a Novel, a Novel as History. Norman Mailer took part in October 1967 anti-Vietnam march to the Pentagon and was arrested after his release. He came home to write about the anger and hangover, the obscenities, the gurus, the hippies, the bewildered young MPs, and the dead-eyed marshals, poets, chaplains, draft card burners on the wall of the Pentagon. That's what this is about. It's a classic. And I also had this by Walker Percy, Love in the Ruins, but I figure I could take it to the book nook, sell it for a dollar. I bought it for a quarter. This I was really pleased to find. I love biographies. And I found a biography on John Brown, the abolitionist. It's called To Purge This Land with Blood, a biography of John Brown. So yeah, I was really, really pleased to find this. It was also recommended here by Eric Fawner, who's a very prominent American historian. I have his books downstairs. I didn't bring them up, but so yeah, I was really pleased to find this on John Brown. To Purge This Land with Blood, a biography of John Brown by Stephen B. Oates. And I found a biography on the Caesar, the Roman Emperor, a biography by Christian Meyer. This is translated out of German by David Mitlach. I collect books on ancient Greece, ancient Rome, Greece, Athens. I'm not really an authority on the Roman emperors or Roman history or ancient. I just, since in the Bible, when you read the New Testament, there's the Epistle of Romans, and Romans was the center of early Christianity, and so that's why I kind of have an interest in Rome, because of its of Christianity and its Rome's place in the spread of Christianity throughout the world, the known world of that time. And I had this biography, but mine's a beat up old hardback. I found this one's a better condition. This is a biography of the one of the champions of the conservative movement. William F. Buckley considered him a mentor. He was Reagan gave him the some kind of a medal. I can't remember now what it was. Look him up. Whittaker Chambers by Sam Tanahas. This is a very famous biography. Look it up if you want to know more about this guy. So those are the things I found this morning at a thrift store before I came home from my walk out in the woods. Glad to find this biography of John Brown, which I don't have any. And I've been looking for a long time, because he's one of the interesting, Henry Thoreau wrote a defense on John Brown when he was arrested for his Harper's Ferry, I think, and taking over that armory and killing some Union soldiers or something like that. I can't remember right now. In the mail, I got a CD by the heavy metal group, the black metal group, Nightbringer. This is Terra Damnia. So I got that in the mail today for those who are into death metal, black metal. So that's what's going on here this Good Friday. Friday reads tomorrow. I guess I volunteer at the Book Nook. I'm not sure what I will take to read tomorrow. I might just continue reading Zama, and then after I finish reading this, I'll start reading 2,000 Years. Or, I don't know. But I have been enjoying these books, Spirit Hermeneutics, Reading Scripture in the Light of Pentecost by Greg S. Keener, Scripture as Real Presence by Hans Boersma, and Reading the Bible Supernaturally, Seeing and Savoring the Glory of God in Scripture by John Piper. So it's been really a blessing in the morning, reading the Word of God and seeing the glory and the beauty of Christ within the pages of Holy Scripture. And, you know, one thing else I was going to close, people have been saying to me, have a happy Easter. Well, you know how I know what we should say is that thank the Lord that He rose from the dead. That's what Easter is all about. Like I said, Sunday is not Easter. Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. It's when we celebrate the risen Lord, that he did not just lay in the grave, but He rose from the dead on the third day. And 40 days later, He ascended into heaven. And now he reigns over all of reality. He is the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. And one day we're all going to stand before Him. Either we're going to stand in terror or stand in praise. And so this coming Easter or Resurrection Sunday, remember that Jesus rose from the dead because He is the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. So hoping you're having a good Friday, that you are rejoicing in the death of Christ. Have a good weekend, and I'll make a video tomorrow or Sunday. I don't know. We'll see. Thank you for the comments. Thank you for sticking around. Until next time. Bye.